began long padayatra all over the hills to observe the devastation brought about by deforestation. And at the age of 40, he was called as an environmental activist. And as we all know, he is called as a leader of Chipko movement. Actually, this movement was started by the women, a group of women in Garhwal. They came together and hugged the tree to protect trees which were being cut down. So it was started in 1973. Sundarlal Bahuguna was the one leader who joined to support this movement. It was started in the place of Uttarakhand, then a part of Uttar Pradesh. This is the main motto of this movement was to protect trees from being cut down. So it is also called as Forest Conservation Movement. Sundarlal Bahuguna, he did not only work for the as an environmentalist, but he also worked against untouchability, and he also worked for women welfare and anti-liquor drive. So just we can see, he is not just called as an environmentalist. He has worked in different aspects of life. Whatever, wherever he could contribute his from his side to whatever society, he did his best. So he worked for untouchability, and he fought for women welfare and also for anti-liquor drive. And also there was a mega project to construct a dam over Ganga River. Even for this, he fought against that to protect our nature. So he was called as Voice of Nature and the Voice of Himalaya and the Voice of the Ganga. Sundarlal Bahuguna, he used to follow principles of Gandhi. So he was called as Gandhian. And he also went for a long march in a Himalayan march of around 4,700 kilometers on foot. While he was passing through this journey, he started observing and started having a keen observation on forest, nature, and to try to know what are the consequences, what are the problems, how we are destroying the nature. He started having observation on these aspects. And he also started observing the degradation of social life in the village because of the deforestation. And he was called as man of the era because he was the inspiration to many of the youths. He also constructed a Saryaha ashram in Tehri Garhwal. He inspired many young people in his passion for the environment. So he used to always motivate people to have a passion towards environment and nature, how we have to conserve it, how we should contribute towards the nature. He's always had a dialogue, or he started encouraging each youth to take step ahead to conserve nature. His ashram was open to young people with whom he communicated with ease. And also he has written many books, that is India's Environment, Myth and Reality, An Environmental Crisis and Humans at Risk, and Bhoo Prayog Mein Bunyadi Parivartan Ki Dharti Ki Pukar, and Ecology is a Permanent Economy. And the last one is The Activism and Environmentalism of Sundarlal Bahuguna. And he also has received many awards, such as in 1987, he has received Right Livelihood Award for Chipko Movement. And in 1986, he has received Jamnalal Bajaj Award for Constructive Work. And in 1989, he has received honorary degree of Doctor of Social Sciences, was conferred by IIT Roorkee. And in 2009, Padma Vibhushana Award by Government of India for Environment Conservation. And in 1987, he also got Padma Shri Award, but as he was fighting for Tehri Dam project, but that was not successful. But he refused this award, that is Padma Shri Award. Okay. So as we have seen, what are the contribution and how he has worked selflessly towards saving of the nature, like there are certain reports given. So let us have a look of these reports. So are we aware of these reports? So the first report was from UNESCO's World in 2030 public survey. There are certain issues and problems listed in this public survey, and in that the topmost one is related to environment, and the second one is minerals. Oxford University, Stockholm Environment Institute. And in the third one is environmental performance index. We are ranking 188 out of 180,
I'm
168.
sorry to interrupt you, Daneshwari, but I think PPT is not visible in the on the screen. Please share your PPT. I request Pratibha Naik madam to stop presenting your screen, ma'am. Sorry for the interruption.
Let us have a look of these reports. The first one is UNESCO's report, World in 2030 Public Survey. In this, there are certain issues that have been listed, but in the topmost, there is an issue regarding environment. And the second one is Minerals, Oxford University, Stockholm Environment Institute. In this, there is so many plastics has been collected in the oceans every year. And the third one is Environmental Performance Index. We are ranking 168 out of 180 countries. So we can just we can think over like where we are standing in the ranks. And the fourth one is Air Quality Report in Ghaziabad city is the most polluted city in the world, because the Ghaziabad city is located nearby Delhi. And the wind that flows from Delhi has been collected in this city. So it is reported as a most polluted city in the world. So now we have got to know what are the problems that we have. Okay, so how the world is looking towards these kind of problems. The first one is, what are the initiatives taken by the world? The first one is Summit on Climate. Here in last month on April 22nd, World Earth Day, on this day there was a summit in which Biden has told about the carbon neutrality and also zero carbon emission, where in this summit around 40 countries had gathered to discuss about these problems. So what is this carbon neutrality? Here they are going to introduce a machine where it can absorb carbon dioxide that is left into the air. It is going to absorb carbon dioxide from the environment. So this is our motto. By 2050, we are going to achieve this. And the second one is the Conference of Parties 26. This is also another conference meeting where from different countries, leaders come and have a discussion on problems regarding these issues. And this will be conducted in November 1st or 2nd week. Okay, the coming to the next one is how India is looking forward towards these kind of problems. Like what are the Indian government schemes? The first one is Ankur scheme. It is from Madhya Pradesh, where they have released one application, that is app, called as Vayu Dut, in which a person can register himself whenever he plants a particular sapling. He just have to register himself, and once in a month he has to upload a picture of that particular plant which he has planted. So there is a consistent follow-up of developmentation of that plant. So as in when he uploads in the app, on consistent time, he will be receiving an award called as Pran Vayu. They will be observing that plant's growth, and on based on that, the person will be receiving an award called as Pran Vayu. And second one is PM Kusum Yojana. It is a scheme with regard to farmers, because farmers are using many machines based on diesels. to uplift the water and for certain functions. But government has come forward to replace it with the solar panels, where these diesel machines can be replaced by solar panels. So as we all know that Sundarlal Bahuguna has given the best slogan as ecology is permanent economy. So coming to the word ecology, what is ecology? Ecology is something that is the relationship between the living beings and the living beings and the environment. That phenomena or that harmonious relationship between these two is called ecology. So as we have seen in last three slides, that what are the problems and what are the schemes, and as we all know, for any schemes we need certain amount budget to be taken from the government. So but when we are trying to keep nature as it is and safe without destroying it much, I think we don't have to invest money on schemes. So if we keep it secure, we don't have to spend so much of money on these schemes, rather than keep just we have to keep it as it is, like we have to protect it. So ecology is permanent economy. In this way, we can best way we can save the amount of the whatever budget of the country. And as we all have seen all of these problems and solutions, and also we have seen consistent efforts how Sundarlal Bahuguna sir has made from beginning of his childhood till his last moment, how he has made efforts. And recently we have lost him. But the best way to remember him is, I think, how we can take step ahead by imbibing at least few of the points that he has done for the nature. I think if we take away at least a single point from him and try to educate the next generation, I think that's the best way to remember him. So let us all be the part of solution and not the part of pollution. So to remember him forever, let us make contribution towards this environment. Thank you.
Thank you, Daneshwari, for making us aware, re-aware about the life journey and achievements of Sri Sundarlal Bahuguna ji. Now I request Mr. Akash to display the further work which is carried out by, again, our students. Over to you, Akash.
Thank you, ma'am. Good evening, everyone. Now I'll be displaying a PPT which is done by students that has portraits of Sir Sundarlal Bahuguna as well as quotes written by some of our students.
This portrait is drawn by our student Chaitra Mattapati, who is in MSc second semester. We in Himalaya are facing a crisis of survival due to suicidal activities being carried out in the name of development. This is a quote written by our student. Again, there is one portrait which is drawn by Shweta Zadav. This is a famous quote by Sri Sundarlal Bahuguna ji. The solution of present day problem lies in the re-establishment of harmonious relationship between the man and the nature. The portrait of Sri Sundarlal Bahuguna ji by Shalini Rajput. Another quote by Sri Sundarlal Bahuguna ji. Portrait by again Shalini. It is a man-made disaster when you try it forcefully to change the nature and its landscape. It gets back and punishes you. So the last quote, what was displayed, I think what we are experiencing now, and as the slogan of this year Environmental Day is, recover, reimagine, and restore. I think in this pandemic, the nature is restoring itself. The best preparation for good work for tomorrow is to do good work today. I think I feel proud to tell all the participants that this program is entirely organized by our students. They have taken the first initiative to do something like this. And also they have lined up some of the offline initiatives which will be conducted after, once the lockdown gets open. Now, there is one video made by again our students regarding the life, overall life story of the Sundarlal Bohuguna ji. I request once again Akash to display the video. Akash, please increase voice.
Come on. I'm extremely sorry. I'll just restart it once again.
Biography of a great environmentalist, Sundarlal Bohuguna. The world indeed has witnessed and inspired an eminent environmentalist from time to time. India has also witnessed the rise of notable warrior of Mother Earth to protect its natural environment. It's the great Garhwali environmentalist, Sundarlal Bohuguna. Sundarlal Bohuguna was born on January 9, 1927 in Maroda village in the Tehri district, a hilly region of Uttarakhand. His father, Ambadat Bohuguna, served in the forest department and mother became a farmer after fleeing the tragic partition of India and Pakistan. He started his primary education from Tehri and then went to Lahore for his BA graduation. Later, then to Varanasi for his post-graduation degree. Sundarlal Bahuguna was inspired by Mahatma Gandhi's call for strength of non-violence and fasting. Hence, he was also called as Gandhian environmentalist. As a teenager, at the age of 13, Bahuguna became an active participant in social activities. However, stopped his studies to join the freedom struggle. It was the start of his journey and public movements. The first social drive among this includes his fight against untouchability practices. Sundarlal Bahuguna grew up as a social activist under the inspiration of Sridev Suman, who was a nationalist spreading the message of nonviolence. He was associated with the Indian National Congress before the country's independence. Hence, Bahuguna's political career began at the age of 17. He was imprisoned for taking part in the freedom struggle. At the age of 22, Bahuguna met social activists Meera Ben and Thakkar Bappa and got interested in a social work. Despite hailing from an affluent Brahmin family, he went on to work for welfare of Dalits and also other tribal people. He also opened school for the untouchables. While working as a social activist, Sundarlal Bahuguna met Vimala, who was committed as a social worker. In 1956, both decided to marry. As he adopted Gandhian principles in his life, he together with wife Vimala, they chose to live among the rural people in the foothills of Himalayas. There they established their ashram and worked for the education of Dalits and poor. In 1960, responding to Vinoba Bhave's call, Sundarlal Bahuguna joined Padayatras across the hills to propagate his message across 7 districts. Did you know that he started with anti-liquor drive? Yes. Collaborating with the women folks of his locality, Bahuguna also organized anti-liquor campaign during 1965 to 1970. In 1973, before leaving for Canada to pursue PhD, Sundarlal Bahuguna visited his favorite forest, but the forest was gone and the stream was reduced to a trickle. Considering this, he led the Chipko movement for protecting the trees and natural resources. A flashback was reached on March 26, 1947, when a group of village women in Chamoli district restored to hugging trees to prevent them from being felled. Inspired by Gandhi and to make this movement even more popular, Bahuguna walked from Srinagar in Jammu and Kashmir in northern India to Kohima in Nagaland in eastern India, covering more than 4,700 km by foot and observed the damage done by mega developmental projects. He also met the former Prime Minister Indira Gandhi, a meeting that is said to have paved the way for ban on falling of green trees for 15 years. The famous slogan coined by Bahuguna for this conservation movement resonates the reality. That is, ecology is a permanent economy. The Chipko movement received the Right Livelihood Award, also called as Alternative Nobel Prize. Another notable instance from his life is his active participation to anti-Tehri Dam project. He undertook one of India's longest fast after independence, over 56 days to oppose the Tehri project, and stationed on the banks of river Bhagirathi firmly during 1980 to 2004. He also supported Beej Bachao Andolan. In the early 1990s, he reorganized the Save Himalaya movement. Sundarlal Bahuguna inspired and groomed many others who dedicated themselves to the social and environment cause. In 1986, he was also awarded Jamnalal Bajaj Award for constructive work. Considering his noteworthy service achievement, the country awards him Padma Vibhushana in 2009. Despite the changing times, the symbolism of Bahugunas movement lives. In Mumbai in 2017, activists hugged more than 3,000 trees to protect them from metro railway facility. Sundarlal Bahuguna has also written wonderful books on conservation, such as India's Environment, Myth and Reality, Ecology is Permanent Economy, so on. Recently, on May 21st, 2021, we have lost a gem, the voice of nature, due to COVID-19. Looking back at Sundarlal Bahuguna's life, the nation will still remember him as a catalyst of nature.
Thank you, Daneshwari and Akash, for taking efforts to show us the life journey of Sri Sundarlal Bahugunaji. I request all the participants to observe 2 minutes silence in the memory of Sri Sundarlal Bahugunaji, and let us pray the Atma attains Sadgati. Thank you. Even though great people demise from this earth, but their ideas and their thoughts remain from generation to generation. I hope every one of us remembers his work and continue to contribute to save our environment. Thank you. With this, our first session of webinar comes to an end. Our second session is about a special talk by Dr. Srinath Kavde sir on the topic Our Environment, Our Future. I request Ms. Shruti to introduce our resource person, Dr. Srinath Kavde sir. Over to you, Shruti.
Good evening, one and all. It's my pleasure to welcome such an intellectual person whose knowledge is priceless, at the same time kind, humble, and down to earth, as that of Dr. Srinath Kavde, an environmentalist and vice president of Socially and Economically Backward Communities, Pune. Sir is a qualified PhD scholar in botany and specialized in angiosperm taxonomy. He served as assistant professor and was head of Department of Botany in Arts, Commerce and Science College in Lanja, which comes under Ratnagiri district of Maharashtra. Sir was invited by Ambassador of Ecuador of India for research collaboration for the project Prometeo-Sibios project in Ecuador. Sir has published around 16 research publications and 6 are in communication. Sir has worked with various organizations like Botanical Survey of India, National Defense Academy, Pimpri-Chinchwad Municipal Corporation, Research Wing, Maharashtra Forest Department, Indian Army, etc. Sir is an honorable founder member and vice president of Trees for the Future India and life member of Indian Association for Angiosperm Taxonomy. He was also a part of indigenous tree plantation program carried out in Western Ghats of Maharashtra, where more than 1 lakh seedlings were planted. Sir has made a record in Pune University by giving a lecture for continuous 7 hours. Sir was awarded by University Grants Commission Travel Grant Fellowship to attend 2011 International Biodiversity Conference, Benoist Equator, South America. Sir was nominated for International Award AABS Young Innovator Award 2012. Sir was awarded with Fellow of Association for the Advancement of Biodiversity Science. Sir was awarded Nisarg Pujak Puraskar by SACAD on Association of World Environment Day on 5th June 2010. Once again, I welcome you, sir, for being the resource person of today's webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, Shruti. The introduction given by Shruti is very short and brief, but the achievements of SIRS are long and it will take us together to explain all of them. We personally have, our students have interacted with the SIR, and SIR has left a very strong inspiration on our students, and some of the activities SIR has been guided, our students are already taking them in action. So now I request Dr. Srinath Kavde sir to take over the session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sheetal ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yes, sir.
Namaskar, good evening. I would like to say happy World Environment Day to all of you. Respected principal of GSS College, Professor Majukar sir, HOD, Botany, Professor Halgikar, HOD, Zoology, all dignitaries and participating students and nature lovers. As we all know that since 1972, today's, that is 5th June, is celebrating World Environment Day in entire world with a specific theme. As this year's theme is ecosystem restoration. As we know that ecosystem plays a very important role. Am I audible or is it?
Audible, sir, audible.
The sound is good?
Yes, sir, yes.
Okay, I'm getting some echo.
Audible, sir.
Okay.
No problem.
After a wonderful presentation and first session with respect to the great environmentalist, the legendary personality, Sri Sundarlalji Bahuguna, for his commendable efforts in entire environmental issues in India, for his wonderful commendable efforts for the conservation of nature, conservation of trees, and especially he took the involvement of community. I think it was the first of its kind that community has involved for the protection of nature, for the protection of trees. I would like to say that he was a true warrior of Mother Earth. His efforts are really unforgettable by our future generations. Dear participants, I would like to present now with respect to our today's topic, that is our environment, our future. As we know that India is one of the richest country with the habitat diversity, then the diversity in the algae, fungi, bryophytes, pteridophytes, angiosperms, gymnosperms. Now, I would like to take you to the journey to the land of diversity. As we know that India has three wonderful places where there is a great variations in the climate, great variations in the diversity, the plants, birds, animals, and so on. Those places are Northeast Himalayan ranges, Northeast India, where there is the Eastern Himalayas, then Andaman and Nicobar Islands, and the next one is our Western Ghats, or we also call it as a Sahyadri ranges. As we know that the diversity in plants and animals, which shows variations, and such variability of life on earth is nothing but the biodiversity. Such biodiversity or the variation is there in the different species at ecosystem level, and obviously it is because of different habitats, different environmental conditions, mountains, valleys, rainfalls, water bodies, and so on. So far, India is concerned, it has 12% of world's recorded flora. This is a wonderful thing. In entire world, India has this great representation of the flora. It is showing world's highest rainfall place, that is in Meghalaya Cherrapunji. Personally, I visited that place. It is really a wonderful place to work to visit. And right from that high rainfall area to very dry desert, right from coastline to alpine regions where there is a Leh and Ladakh, our region is there. I personally also got opportunity to have a visit to Leh, Pangong Lake, and other Jojila Pass, and then the high altitude floristic components. Right from that, river deltas to tropical islands are also found in this particular our country. And so far, Indian forests are concerned, more than 600 species of trees are there. This number is really speaking very high. So far, our number of species in India, that is 21,000, is concerned. Along with this, India has the richest variety of bird diversity. India have 29% endemic taxa, the taxa which is not found elsewhere in the world. That is a wonderful thing. And because of this tremendous diversity in birds, animals, reptiles, mammals, plants, as I have mentioned, India is one of the 18th mega biodiversity regions of the world. It is, the photo is just behind to you. The photo is taken from Nane Ghat. It is really a wonderful thing that the Nane Ghat is ancient trade route. The area was used for the trading by many foreigners, especially Greek and Romans in those days. Now, habitat diversity. If we see the environment, our environment, we should know what environmental components are there. As we know that environment is nothing but the soil, air, and water. All these things are, really speaking, controlling the living components. Therefore, this region is representing the diversity, which is hottest hotspot place, where I'm talking about the Western Ghat, that is Sahyadri. As I told you that, it is covering almost more than 7,000 species of flowering plants, then 139 mammal species, physoric bird species. These numbers are there, number of species are there. But I would like to show you the components. This particular carving is found on the lateritic plateaus. We get such beautiful bed. Carving is nothing but a strobilanthus. Let me tell you, friends, our Western Ghat is representing more than 24 species of carving or strobilanthus. Out of that, almost 14 species are not found elsewhere in the world. This is the beauty. And one more thing is there, that is, this particular carve flowers, few species flowers, once in 14 years, like Neelukurunji, which is found in Nilgiri Hills. The another one, Carvia callosa flowers once in 14 years. And certain carves like this Mara carve is flowering every year. Now, the way the plants are flowering, it is playing important role in environment. It is acting as important resource of food, not only for the insects, but also for the butterflies. Then this region act as a wonderful place for many mammals, many reptiles, and no doubt for humans, major source of the honey is given by such wonderful species of carvi. Now, there are almost 30 species, places in Western Ghat which are declared by UNESCO as a natural world heritage site in 2012. To try to understand that these 39 places are not only our heritage, but it becomes a heritage of entire world. That means from global point of view, people are expecting many things from you, that what you have with you, that is diversity. What you have, the only thing with you, that is endemic plants, endemic birds, endemic mammals, critically endangered species that you have with you, you have to take care of your own wealth, that is the expectation. And such beautiful places are there. This is the Kaas Plateau. This is one of the UNESCO World Heritage Site, we called as a Valley of Flower of Maharashtra. Let me tell you that almost 36 endemic species has been recorded from this small region, small part of the plateau. This Kaas Plateau is located just near to Satara. There are so many plant species which are named after Satara city. These are the terrain representing habitats, tropical moist deciduous, tropical stunted evergreen, then the vegetation on the steep slope, vegetation just near to the stream, near the waterfall. Why waterfall? Because in Karnataka, when I was doing my research work in Botanical Survey of India, Ministry of Environment and Forest has given one task, whether the critical endangered species or rare plants, endemic species are there in the habitat or not. Then we visited personally Joke Falls. One plant, one small grass, namely Hubbardia heptaneron. It was recorded for the first time. That means Joke Falls was the type locality. But when we search it in a very systematic way, but we could not able to found it. Fortunately, Professor S.R. Yadav, he recorded the same species from one habitat, one place near Kolhapur. That was a really wonderful thing. Otherwise, we assume that the species has been vanished, has been extinct from the type locality. That's why small microhabitats are really playing a very, very important role, vital role in conservation. Now, what we say, our outer side environment, our environment, what is this? Is nothing but the humus which is developed itself in the forest. It is really speaking the factories of nutrients they are providing to the trees, not only trees but herbaceous members, shrubs, climbers, and the future generation of jungle. They are coming out of this particular leaf eaters. And along with this, there are, you know, tremendous diversity. This is our environment. Forest starts from this place, this leaf eater, or we call it as a humus. Likewise, our incredible Western Ghat shows a tremendous, you know, variations with respect to habitat. If you see, this cliff, many therapeutic as well as bryophytic plants are there. Here, the aquatic habitats are there. In the right side, small stream you can see. During monsoon season, this stream carries fresh water. But once the rainfall stops or it gets reduced, we get this beautiful pink color flowers.
Excuse me, sir. PPT is not visible. Please.
My slides are not visible?
Yes, sir. It's not visible.
Just a moment. Sorry for interruption. Actually,
no problem, sir. Actually, PPT was visible to me. I don't know about others.
Just.
Okay. Many PPTs not visible.
One member presented screen. That's why it was not visible after that.
No, how many slides did you saw?
Sir, only four slides.
Sir, starts from micro habitat. Started from micro habitat, I think.
Chital madam, let's other two ones. Say because you only.
Only four slides
okay.
are visible.
Okay. What I will do? I will just repeat it. Okay.
Yeah, sir. No problem.
Just what I said is with respect to the plant species.
I please request every participant, please don't share your screens and mute your audios and videos. Otherwise, there will be interruption.
Can you see this?
Yes, sir. Now it is visible.
Okay. This is the Mar Carvi. Okay. Now, this is the Karst Plateau. Unique habitat in the world. These plateaus are really speaking wonderful habitat. Our outer environment, what it is doing, these plateaus are, you know, having a unique habitat. The laterite and this particular plateaus or rock, lateritic rock is lacking the soil. It takes, you know, hundreds of years, thousands of years to form good quality soil. And it took several years to form this. The pink flowers, all these are impatiens. These species are formed or developed where there is a very less amount of soil of just 1 to 2 inches thickness. To try to understand, to get this particular soil, to get this particular beautiful impatiens, this rock has to face several environmental, you know, factors, environmental, climatic, the conditions like temperature. The temperature is reaches up to 55 degrees Celsius in summer season. In winter season or in the monsoon season, it reduces up to 4 to 5 degrees Celsius. I would like to tell you only one parameter, how one parameter is regulating the growth, the weathering pattern of this particular rock and the growth or the formation of soil and then the growth of this particular plant. Now, these are the habitats what I have already mentioned. This is also the humus. Then these are the micro habitats. Now, this pink color, you see, the pink color plants, I will show you the photo. This plant is a Pogostemon deccanensis, which is endemic to our region. Now, only found in our region. Now, this plant, this is interesting plant. I have recorded after 161 years. Okay, and this is the plant, this Pogostemon deccanensis. The plants are beautiful, which plays a very important role from ecological point of view. Many people says that, sir, what is the use of this plant? What is the use of that plant? What is the use of trees? Whether the fruits are edible, whether the leaves are edible for me. But very few people ask question whether any plant is giving the service to the ecosystem, to the environment, or to a specific insect. Very few people. That is the problem with us. Now, you see, the plateau during pre-monsoon condition during summer season, it looks barren. But during and after monsoon, we see the beautiful flowers. This is the Augustema decanensis. And as I told you that certain plants like Aponogeton satarensis, why I'm telling the major examples of from Maharashtra, because Maharashtra has very
sir,
high number
sorry
of
to interrupt you. Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
So again, the PPT is not visible to many participants.
Just a moment.
So once again, share it and see.
Just a moment.
And I request all the participants to please rejoin or pin the PPT to your screen and see.
Is it visible now?
Yes, sir.
For those whose it is not visible, please pin to your screen the same PPT, then it will be visible. I think to many it is visible, to some participant it is not visible.
Why I'm telling major species of herbaceous plants, because they are representing so-called, you know, grassland ecosystem or a barren area, and Maharashtra is concerned, the herbaceous species are more visible and they are getting more opportunity to develop themselves. And let me tell you, since last 10 years, so far Maharashtra state is concerned or the adjoining areas are concerned, the floristic representation or new species come out more from Maharashtra. We try to understand, more and more exploration work has been carried out in different habitats, different forts, different plateaus and different kinds of vegetations. That's why you see the name has been given like Habenera panchagonensis, Ceropegia jaini, or Ceropegia santapoi, Abeton ranidi, then Aponogeton satarensis. No doubt there are many species in Karnataka also which are representing particular habitat. Actually, one plant, Ceropegia candelabrum, I have recorded for the first time to India. Earlier, it was reported from Sikkim only. But fortunately, I recorded it from Bannerghatta National Park. In 2001, Bannerghatta National Park was my first research topic. I studied there for almost 3.5 years. But unfortunately, due to technical reason, I could not go forward. Now, this is the different types of carvies. You can see the color variation, even their beauty with respect to flowers. These are different Ceropegias. The beautiful nature is there. This particular ant is taking sugary substance nectar from endemic plant, that is Maulova spicata, which is there in Karnataka, Kerala also. These are the real chemists, what we get outside our home, what we get in nearby environment, nearby nature, that butterflies. Let me tell you, in environment, in nature, what are the different parameters for the good and healthy environment? I think there are three parameters. Three B's are there. Three B's means letter B. Number one is birds. Number two is butterflies, and number three is bees, that is honeybees. If such three parameters are there, that means the outermost environment is in good condition, in healthy condition. These are the representation of what are happening in the outside environment. One has to read whether this part, our region is with this great pied hornbill. I heard from many of you that in Belgaum, then nearby areas, this grapevine hornbill is also recorded. Let me tell you, friend, this representation is the healthy representation of nature. Now let me tell you one more example, that Belgaum is the only site of one bat colony which is there in the, which is there near to Belgaum. That is the only locality in the world where there are thousands of lakhs of bats are there located just nearby to your Belgaum. One of my friend Nilesh Malpure, he has done his PhD on flora of Belgaum district. Now there are, you know, services by the plants. We have to see our environment, our future. Now let me tell you, we can see our environment with respect to the representation by certain birds, representation by certain butterflies, reptiles, bats, some plants. Now they have their healthy relation with the nature, in the sense other compounds or components of the nature like such trees. Now these bombax, representing bombaceae, giving a wonderful services during its flowering period, like February, March. What is there in this particular photo? Photo is there which showing the flowers. The close of a flower is there. Many number of stamens are there. The flower petal color is scarlet, or sometimes we get pinkish or reddish. Such variation we get. Such attraction is there for the birds. Now birds are there. How many birds are there? Species wise, there are many birds are visiting this particular bombax, but 28 different species of birds they used to visit during that particular period. Not only birds, but many honeybees, many other insects they used to visit that particular bombax to collect not only nectar but also to get pollen grains from that particular flower. Now these are the ecological services. These are the, you know, association amongst plants and animals, plants and insects. Now we have such association, but is this healthy association in the current scenario, in current environmental issues? I would like to say no. We are moving away from environment, away from our mother earth, away from our nature. Now we are restricted to our greed, we are restricted to our use, our need from the nature. Now we should have to consider the giving back phenomenon. We should have to giving back, return something to the nature through different phenomenon, through different activities. Now we know that there is a diversity, tremendous diversity, through medicinal plants as well as wild vegetables. We have diversity in mangoes. 800 different types of or species of varieties of mangoes are there in India. See this particular exhibition we used to carry out in Pune and Goa on the occasion of International Day of Biological Diversity. We would like to say, show people the diversity at your footstep or door foot. We took many fruits or the tubers, combs, their wild fruits like, you know, jackfruits, jamun, then Carissa carandus, we call it as a Kali Maina or a Karvanda. We have 32 different forms of Kali Maina is there. We have 16 types of jamun. Many people used to take jamun for, you know, it's a, you know, seasonal fruit, but very few people knew that certain jamun that doesn't change their color, they remain greenish or yellowish green. This is the beauty. One has to experience such different varieties of the taste of jungle, that is mangoes. Nowadays they are in good taste. And we have this endemic reddish orange, you know, plant, that is kokum, amsul, kokum, garcinia. We have 4-5 species of garcinia, but many of them are strictly endemic to our region. Now very few people used to go for the cultivation of this particular indigenous wealth in the process of plantation. What we have to do? We have to think our own way. We have to develop environment and environment related activities nearby region where nature needs nurture. Then what we can do, we shall provide certain signages for the spices. India is spice producing country. I came to know that in different places, different ports where the major area where the spices was the main material of trading, and majority of countries like Greek, England, then Germany and France, they used to collect different varieties, different, you know, type of spices. They used to collect from different places. They used to collect cotton from eastern part of Karnataka, then eastern part of Maharashtra. They used to collect it and they used to make the trading of this particular indigenous kind of things. Now, we should have to consider the most important part of our environment, that is honeybees. As people says, when honeybees get vanished, in next 2 to 3 years, human beings get vanished. Because 60% pollination work is done by honeybees. That is one of the most important thing which honeybees are doing. Our interest, honeybees, what they are doing, we don't know. Our interest is just honey. What kind of honey? No, they have different, you know, kind of, you know, branding like Dabur honey. I'm not against them, like Patanjali honey, different names are there. But what about purity? What about the assurance whether this particular honey is directly prepared by the bees, directly collected from the forest, or they are pure? No one can say. As we have different varieties, you can see the range of diversity of honeybees, right from Apis dorsata, then Apis acerina indica, then stingless bees and so on. All these bees, they are feeding the our jungle species, whether they are in full bloom or they are in sparse condition. They are used to visit not only for the nectary, but many times they used to visit pollen grains. Such kind of association one has to consider so far the protection of our environment is concerned. This is the pollination services, which is one of the most important thing for the growth, for the nature, for the development. These are the two different types of honey. There are almost, you know, 16 to 17 types of honey. But type means what? Dabur honey. Dabur honey has only one color. Honey color is variable. How? Because color, taste and the components is depending on from which plant species the nectar has been collected by the honeybees. That is very, very important. And people from many regions, they used to go for the purity or the systematic or sustainable way of beekeeping. Now the naturopathy going to towards the nature, such kinds of, you know, activities, field-based educational activities for nature conservation can be possible by involvement of our young blood, our power of nation, that is youth, all you, all of you, through the celebration of Tiger Day, selfie with tree, then the preparation of certain seed balls. Nowadays, this particular activity, it's very good. It takes less efforts to get assurance for the germination. One has to select specific nature, local need-based seeds or local need-based plant species. You can select and you can make seed balls. You just throw it, throw out somewhere near to your area. This is one of the, you know, if you prepare, say, 1,000 seed balls, but out of 1,000, if 100 or 50 seeds gets germinated, that is your contribution. If you prepare 1 lakh seed balls, the probability may be less, but awareness. You are making people aware. You are taking help, their help in the conservation, in the protection of nature. When I who had just joined Lanja College. Lanja, I love Lanja College because Lanja gave so many things to nurture my hobbies or my profession with respect to plants and biodiversity and its conservation. What I saw, this. Many forests, good quality forests, used to cut down by local communities to fulfill our requirement of mangoes, our requirement of cashew nuts, our requirement of cocoa, our requirement of coffee and tea also. What we are doing? We are cutting, we are really promoting local people to cut their trees and fulfill our requirement. Now, in that time, in those time, we published so many things in local newspaper. The news came for 15 days rest thing. Gone. What we did, we took help, those who have been involved in cutting the trees. We paid them and we took their help. We involved them for the development of nursery. We have developed our own nursery with 1 lakh seedlings. What you can do with respect to the conservation? Now, these are the efforts. We selected different seeds which have potential for the germination. We collected them from nearby good quality forest, nearby sacred groves, where there is a, you know, relic species, tall trees are there. We collected seeds like Terminalia cebula, Terminalia bellerica, then Terminalia arjuna, and so many species we have collected, and then we started to develop the activities. You know, this lady, she was, you know, just sitting, she was sitting at home and doing only, you know, monsoon period work, agriculture work, especially cultivation of rice. What about the rest of the activities? Just sitting at home. I took, our NGO took her help and we involved this particular lady for the preparation of good quality nursery. Even college students, they took help. Okay. What happened? After, you know, 2 years, Trees for the Future, Lauderdale, America, they published a success story of this particular lady and her daughter's photo they have published on their website. Trees for the Future is internationally renowned organization who took efforts for the plantation. When 2012, the situation was like this. Then 2014, this is the actually 3 years back photo. Now, these plants reached up to 40 feet. No doubt, these plants are mentioned, ecologically not useful, but the person who has the engineering background took efforts for the plantation. Now, this is the success story. Next time, this person is going to plant the local lead-based ecologically important species for the cultivation purpose. See, we have not given the problem, but the solution. What solution? We have to give a specific market for the people. We have to give certain good environment-friendly activities to the college students. Then the plantation drive along the roads, along the highways. Likewise, we should have to promote local communities. No doubt, this Devrai, nothing but a traditional mode of natural gene pool, helping in the conservation of nature, different components of nature, and no doubt, entire environment. Likewise, you are so lucky. Means in many, this photo I have taken somewhere in the Karnataka, must be maybe somewhere in the coastal part of Karnataka. And conservation of, you know, agricultural biodiversity also equally very, very important, because these people, they know which plants are edible and which plants are not edible, which parts are edible. Okay, now one has to take their knowledge, their health, to propagate the our health wealth with respect to their cultivation and expansion of agricultural activities. They have, you know, some more than 40,000 of rice varieties in India. We should have to cultivate it. Likewise, we have these traditional modes of ragi and millets, but nowadays the cultivation is reducing in a very alarming rate. I don't think so in next 20-25 years we will get this particular plants in a market. Likewise, people understood the ethnobotanical aspect, that is the use of local medicines. Now let me tell you, these plants are, many of them are endemic. These guys don't know that these plants are endemic, like this dendrobium is there, this is asparagus, this is a neatum stem, some underground combs and tubers are there. Likewise, these endemic plants are there, but from our side, but from their side, there is a need of their source of not only just a medicine or not only a food but income. They need direction, perfect direction for getting some money. They don't want to build some two-story, four-story building. They need a daily base activities or daily base food. Likewise, we can see their activities. We took efforts for the cultivation of trees. Almost 5 to 6 lakh trees we have cultivated in Pune, Ratnagiri, Sindhudurga and Satara districts of Maharashtra part. No doubt, without the help of Himalaya Drug Company, Nanyuru, then various colleges, local villagers, farmers, women group, then no doubt the students. Likewise, scientific community has to take efforts in understanding our wealth in form of plants, in form of animals. We should have to segregate which are has to be a need of protection at the current situation, and such plants or the floristic component has to be protected or the effort has to be given for their protection. We have carried out mobile exhibition of medicinal plants in different places, almost in the 25 different cities and colleges. We have carried out this campaign. As I mentioned, we have carried out the exhibition in two places, Goa and Pune, and I would like to tell you that in 2016-17 our SEBC is one of the top 15 NGO in India who is celebrating International Day of Biological Diversity. In 2018-19, the secretary of UNEP have sent a letter to me and said that, sir, next year we will definitely have a collaborative arrangement or celebration of International Day of Biological Diversity. That was our recognition. That was our recognition. Likewise, we took the help from local communities. Farmers, they used to come to our exhibitions. They used to talk with the people. They used to represent what they have with them. What they have, like combs, then bulbs, then different kinds of mangoes and so on. Along with this, we have organized photo exhibitions. We have arranged certain competitions with respect to environment, with respect to nature, with respect to biodiversity and so on. Likewise, our efforts are there. We need more and more expansion efforts for its conservation. Now these are the students of Women's College from Pune, more plus 4,450 students. They came to Empress Botanical Garden. They prepared more than 30,000 seed balls in just 4 hours, and in next day we thrown all such seed balls near jungle area. We got very good response from them. The thing is that our students have tremendous energy, power, but they want proper direction, what to do, what not to do. Likewise, one has to show them the direction for the conservation of nature. All these news came during that particular program, and likewise, the plants, they experienced. I have visited Karnataka, coastal Karnataka, then the western part of Karnataka, and collected, you know, different kinds of fruits from the region. I carried variety of rice, variety of chilies. No doubt, this chili is not indigenous. It is, you know, brought from outside India just for a ornamental plant. But afterward, people came to know that chili can be used as spice. We have our own black pepper. We have tamalpatra, dalchini, and then other kinds of, you know, spices in our diet. These are our wealth, indigenous. Majority of them are indigenous agricultural crops. Biodiversity is, really speaking, dealing with these butterflies. They play a very important role. Likewise, our efforts are there to take students to the Dajipur, which is one of the World Heritage Site declared by UNESCO. We are trying to show people the diversity. Now, the GSS college students, we sit here in front of a small, what we can say, Rajwada, because those people are really speaking. Nowadays, we have home, we have money, but we don't have a proper environmental conditions. We cannot go outside. But in this village, Corona dared to visit or dared to go, because no single case was recorded from this particular village. This is a wonderful thing. There are several such villages are there in the interior part of our Western Ghat. We should have to feel, we should have to experience such kind of, you know, environment outside our cities. What we did, we made majority of our environmental components non-useful. Likewise, we should have to go for a particular kinds of projects, maybe long-term basis, maybe short-term basis. We should have to divide our activities with respect to the need of local environment. We should have to take help from school children, then college students, local NGOs, then government body, as we all are educated. Are we going to give the knowledge which is unauthentic? I would like to say no. Our experience, our knowledge, our data, our information should be authentic, should be experienced from the nature, and those things has to be percolated towards the society. We are not just educated because we got the certificate. We are not certified educated people. We should be having the proper system or proper model, proper design of utilization of our consciousness or the knowledge to make aware people more with respect to the environment, our wealth, our health, and our future. Then and only then our today's motto will be furnished. I told you that the state government has felicitated Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj Banashree Award in 2017 because of our the small efforts of conservation, taking help of the people. And Honorable Minister, Chief Minister of Maharashtra, then Vanamantri, they awarded us this prestigious award in the field of plantation. And the future of environment is in your hand. अब हम सबका एक ही सपना प्रदूषण मुक्त हो जीवन अपना. Now on the right side, our future representation is there, who is awaiting what not to hold, what to hold. And I think This is the last part of today's presentation, and I would like to tell you that environment and you is a holistic approach of understanding our surrounding nature, surrounding environment, and in specific to biodiversity from biodiversity point of view, because biodiversity is itself representing whether the environment is good or bad, whether the environment is hurting or not, whether the environment is polluting or not, whether the environment is good for human beings, good for our future generation or not. That is the thing. Lastly, I would like to thank you all again for listening my experience. I'm not a big scientist or a big, you know, kind of research worker. I'm a small person who is going in the jungle, taking whatever experience is there with the nature, and would like to percolate the information what I'm getting from the nature. I'm again thankful to the principal of GSS College, then HOD, Professor Halgikar sir, Professor Majukar sir, Sheetal ma'am, and all dignitaries and student friends. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for making us more familiar with our own biodiversity, that is Western Ghats, which is our real wealth. As the famous quote goes, action speaks a bit louder than the words. And we all, the participants, could see your efforts to conserve the nature through your work. I also would like to explain, express my great thanks to you, because, sir, explain what actions actually we can take through different case studies. Let it might be the indigenous tree plantation programs, or displaying the local biodiversity, or taking active participation of the students to conserve and distribute our own own biodiversity. And I would also like to mention our students of biology department actively take part in tree plantation programs. Also, our college has done QR coding system of all the trees available in our campus, so that even the layman could scan, use the technology, and get to know more familiar with the trees and other biodiversity we have in our campus. Now the session is open for discussion. If anyone has any questions or doubts, you can proceed. Yes, participants, if you have any doubt or question, or you want to ask something to sir, you can ask.
Madhuri Jogalekar wants to ask something. Yes, please.
Yes, ma'am, please proceed.
No question. Am I audible?
Hello, sir. I have a question.
Okay.
Sir, I have a question. Okay, sir. Sir, how can we pursue career in the field of biodiversity conservation?
See, first of all, you should have to understand different components of biodiversity. As right from the recyclers, fungi, bryophytes, pteridophytes, angiosperms, then from animal point of view, insects, reptiles, butterflies, birds, mammals, you have to. You don't have to be a generalized person to understand the biodiversity. you should have to be authority in a particular part, that may be butterflies, but butterflies with respect to their current status, their genetic makeup, something which is very unique. For that purpose, you should have to go for some detailed study. As still our different forests are unexplored. Therefore, one has to reach there, one has to work with respect to their own objectives, and no doubt career is there, future is there with you. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, there is one more question from Dr. Prasad Deshpande, sir. He want to ask you, yes. Does nature needs nurturing? Yes. Does nature needs nurturing?
Yes, sir.
Sir, good evening.
Yes, sir.
In your presentation, you just used the sentence, nature needs nurturing.
Yes, sir.
But my question is, nature, does it needs nurturing? Or is it the way that nature will change its way of functioning whenever it feels that it is in danger?
See, the components of the nature is concerned, they are, you know, dealing their life cycle with respect to change in nature. Change is required because change is there in the nature. But nowadays, what is happening, because of so many anthropogenic factors, so many anthropogenic activities, certain, you know, habitats, they are in danger. What happens? Certain habitats, if it is the home for some rare endangered endemic species, if getting hampered, then it is not our hand to get it back. That's why one has to look after this particular aspect also, because no doubt species, plant species or any biological species, they are there in the nature, and their habitats plays very, very important role with respect to their association, their need within that particular habitat. Okay, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Yes.
Sir, conservation and development don't always go hand in hand. Generally, people don't want to go with the conservation in front of, yes, development. How do you convince, yes, such people?
Just can you repeat the last part, please?
How do you convince such people, or how do you make them feel the importance of conservation?
See, convincing based on scientific information, scientific approach, if you have with you, then I think there is no much problem. No doubt their requirement, their aspect, their approach may be vary, but if you stand on your own, you know, perspective with respect to nature conservation, it will be definitely get affected. It will be definitely get convinced. Because I would like to tell you one example. Almost 20 years back, when Pune-Mumbai Express Highway was started to construct, especially in the Ghat ranges, it was the first expressway in entire India. That time, the construction company thrown away whatever boulders they were there with them, they thrown away in the valley, in that particular jungle where there is a jungle. Then the suit was filed in High Court. High Court told them to take away whatever debris, whatever stones, the materials they thrown away in the jungle. court has given direction to lift everything what they throw, dispose them or spread them somewhere, the place is there. Right, Honorable Sang? The things are happening with us and people has to convince, try to understand. People has to convince there is no other option, because since last 2 years, we are facing big problem with respect to pandemic. The world has stopped. No doubt the reason may be variable. But people has to think from this aspect also, because our greediness has to be stopped somewhere. Because history told that greediness takes us to the end of the community. You got it?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Any other question? I think, sir, questions are over.
Thank you.
I request Akshata to present the vote of thanks.
Good evening, everyone. I, Ms. Akshata, on behalf of GSS College, Botany Department, I deem it a great honor and privilege to propose vote of thanks on this special occasion. First and foremost, I thank to Dr. Srinath Kabde, sir, for being a resource person on this special occasion, to central idea of our environment, our future, that we found particularly interesting and we all are inspired by your words. I thank all our organizers of this function, Dr. Nagaraj D. Hegde, sir, principal of GSS College, Professor B.L. Majukar, sir, coordinator of PG Department of Botany, Professor Arvind Halgekar, sir, coordinator of PG Department of Zoology, and staff members of PG Department of Botany for their stewardship and stinted support for this function. A very hearty thanks to all speakers for gracing and sharing their opinion today. My heartfelt thanks to head of the various department and faculty for valuable contribution. I also thanks the participants of various colleges and universities from Karnataka, Maharashtra, and Goa. Last but not the least, I thank to each and everyone who are attending this virtual webinar, our well-wishers, distinguished invitees present here, and attending this national webinar on a tribute to our leader of GIPCO movement, Sir Sundarlal Bahuguna, and World Environment Day. Finally, I leave the inspiring quote, "It's not yours nor mine, it's ours. So let's protect our mother who nourishes us." Thank you.
Thank you, Akshata. I once again thank all the participants from all the universities and colleges for participating in this webinar. And my heartfelt thank to Dr. Srinath Kavde, sir, for giving us a very broad view regarding our biodiversity and our future. Thank you, sir. I declare that the webinar is over. Thank you once again, everyone.
Thank you again.
इसकी